They are one of the most magnificent creatures on Earth. Graceful and intelligent. They are the largest of the dolphins, and also the ocean's greatest predator. They are called killer whales, orcas. This is the account of one orca that attracted the world's attention. We first came to know him as the star of the hit film Free Willy. But his real name is Keiko. And unlike his computer-created double, he was not freed, but remained in captivity. As you're about to discover, Keiko's ordeal is just as amazing as any Hollywood plot. His plight sparked a monumental human effort to return him to the wild.
We are in serious risk of not getting Keiko out of here.
Join us now for the true story of Free Willy and Keiko's incredible journey home. Keiko's story begins nearly 20 years ago, off the coast of Iceland. In these cold waters, Keiko was born into a highly evolved society of orcas. Air-breathing, warm-blooded mammals like us, orcas have evolved over 35 million years, one of the most advanced social orders found in the animal kingdom. Among their own, they live a peaceful life of social harmony and cooperation. The heart of the family is the orca mother. Like all wild orcas, Keiko would have lived with his mother his entire life in a closely bonded family of brothers, sisters, and his maternal grandmother. Keiko was watched over closely and nursed for the first 18 months before learning to hunt schools of herring, the mainstay of wild orcas in the North Atlantic. Each family of orcas communicates through a complex language of whistles, clicks, and cries. Keiko would have quickly learned to recognize the distinct dialect of his family. Even in the dark depths of the ocean, orcas can recognize each other's calls from miles away. Keiko might have lived in these waters for up to 50 years, but fate would soon change his life forever. The waters of the North Atlantic are rich with schools of herring, hunted not only by orcas, but by humans as well. Always alert to new opportunities, the orcas have learned to follow herring boats, knowing that a free meal awaits them. Keiko's family had also learned this technique. Though the older whales know to stay clear of the nets, the young ones are often overcome by the sight of so much food and are trapped. Normally, fishermen will release the young whales before they are harmed or the nets damaged. Seventeen years ago, during one such feeding frenzy, everything would change for Keiko. The captain of the herring boat, Gudrun, had been offered thousands of dollars to capture a young orca. Keiko is drawn into the net by the teeming school of fish. Once inside, he was trapped. From accounts of other captures, he likely cried out in panic. His mother probably circled the net frantically, but for her baby, there would be no escape. Barely 2 years old, Keiko was taken from his family. His journey into the world of humans had abruptly begun. Orca captures in U.S. waters ended in 1976. And whale traders next came to Iceland to find young animals for a growing industry. Young orcas like Keiko were selected for their ease in handling, transport, and later training. Having survived the trauma of the capture, Keiko is now a very valuable commodity. Brokers arranged for his shipping from Iceland to Marineland of Ontario in Canada. Here in Ontario, Keiko joined six other orcas being trained for sale to amusement parks. He is the youngest of the group and is constantly harassed by the others. Timid, he becomes less marketable and remains in Canada for another 5 years. Then in 1985, Marineland is approached by a park in Mexico City. Keiko is sold for $100,000. His arrival at Reino Aventura Amusement Park is received with great enthusiasm, and he quickly becomes the star attraction. The spectacle of such an exotic creature performing in the middle of Mexico draws enormous crowds. Over the next 7 years, Keiko's size increases dramatically, and his fame grows to celebrity status. For millions of Mexican children, a trip to Reino Aventura and a chance to see Keiko is a dream come true. Then in 1992, Keiko's life takes another strange turn when he lands in a Hollywood movie. The film's producer, Lauren Shuler Donner, casts him in the title role of Free Willy.
Oh, hi, boy! Come on, Willy!
The script called for a whale that was a solo whale in a tank, and it all came down to this one tank in Mexico, in Reino Aventura, where they had a whale, a young whale, in a tank not too fancy, all alone, with a holding tank next to it that we could use.
Let's free Willy. He's got family out there, I heard him.
Co-producer Jenny Lou Tugin also recognized Keiko's intelligence and became concerned for his well-being.
I think that everyone on the crew and certainly the cast came to have their own special relationship with Keiko. That's when our commitment really began, because we knew his plight and we knew that Keiko had to have a new home.
Keiko was living the real life Free Willy. People, of course, would say, well, what are you doing? Why don't you free this whale? And it was like, people, I think, thought we could take the whale, airlift it, drop it into the water, and that would be that. But we couldn't. Keiko would have died.
When the filming ended, no one felt that Keiko should be abandoned in Mexico City.
With complete cooperation from Reno Aventura, the producers contacted Dave Phillips, an experienced whale protection activist, to help devise a rescue plan.
And so we began working with Warner Brothers. And really, this had never been done before. There'd never been a tie-in between a major Hollywood film and a conservation organization working to save wildlife. And so none of us really knew what to expect. We put the number 1-800-4-WHALES at the end of Free Willy, and all of a sudden the switchboards started to light up. Over the course of the next several months, we got 300,000 phone calls. People called from all over the world wanting to get involved with efforts to save the world's whales, and a lot of them were calling because they had heard about the plight of Keiko.
After two long years of intense negotiations, Dave Phillips finally announces a deal. Reno Aventura has agreed to donate Keiko to the newly formed Free Willy Foundation.
But I do think that we have a carefully outlined plan with top scientists in the world working on it and excellent cooperation. And I think that this is the beginning of a very happy ending.
For all the people, the skeptics, who said, it's too expensive, it's too logistically difficult, too many permits, too many governments, too many conflicting veterinary opinions, the kids were always there saying, you've got to make this happen. We won't accept no. All these kids from around the world started becoming the force behind the plan for doing the right thing for Keiko. They put the pressure on Warner Brothers. They put the pressure on Reno Aventura to do the right thing.
For 5 years, trainers Carla Corral and Renata Fernandez have cared for Keiko day and night and are his closest companions.
He's very kind. He's very noble, intelligent also. And I would describe him like a little kid.
He's the most beautiful animal in the whole world. I think he's my best friend. He's everything to me. But he's really gentle and he really cares for us.
Keiko's really capable of love, but we feel it every day. I mean, there's something that words cannot explain.
I think he really trusts us a lot, and he understands, and he kind of talks to me in his way, you know? I think he's even smarter than we are.
As the Free Willy Foundation begins to examine Keiko's living conditions, they find that while he enjoys excellent care from his trainers, there should be great concern for his physical health. Blood tests reveal a weakened immune system. The size of Keiko's pool is too small, and his dorsal fin is atrophied due to lack of exercise. Keiko has a pronounced skin rash caused by a papilloma virus. The condition is aggravated by the chlorinated artificial salt water that is far too warm. He must be moved as soon as possible. But because his virus may be contagious, he cannot be transferred to a park with other orcas. With no facility available, the foundation searches for a coastal site where it will build the world's first whale and dolphin rescue center, with Keiko as its first tenant. A location is found at the Oregon Coast Aquarium near the town of Newport. Here, emphasis is on the rehabilitation of wildlife rather than performance or entertainment. But never has there been a patient the size of Keiko. $7 million are donated by the Macaw Foundation and Warner Brothers, and construction of a new facility begins immediately. Director of the aquarium, Phyllis Bell.
It's been a really short construction schedule, only about 11 months. You really need about 18 to 24 months for a project of this size, but the contractor agreed to do it on a fast-track basis. We did a design-build process, which means the design was going just right ahead of the construction.
With construction underway in Oregon, Dave Phillips returns to Mexico City to organize a team of trainers and veterinarians who will engineer Keiko's relocation.
If we can do some exercise behaviors to get his muscles to be not so stiff, and then...
Dr. Lanny Cornell is a marine mammal veterinarian with extensive experience in the transport of captive orcas. He is chosen to direct the complex operation of Keiko's move.
You guys can give him lots of love and attention, and he'll be a happy boy.
Okay.
Because of the close bond Carla and Renata have developed with Keiko, it is crucial for them also to accompany him to Oregon.
Well, we are planning to go with Keiko, and then to stay with him for a while, maybe 4 to 6 months, until we train a new trainer to train Keiko. When he goes to Oregon, the trip is going to be very long and very stressing because he's going to be in a new place with a different temperature, with different people, different language. Everything's going to be different. So I think it's very, very important that we are with him all the time because, I mean, we are going to be his main support.
After weeks of regular medical examinations, Dr. Cornell reports back from Mexico that Keiko's health appears even more at risk.
We're 2 weeks away from when we're supposed to be moving Keiko, and the veterinarians are extremely concerned with the blood work coming in. We think we have to get Keiko out of there for his health, and that if the blood work comes up any worse than it is now, it could mean that Keiko's life is in danger.
Phillips and Cornell realize that Keiko's deteriorating health has reached a critical stage. If they wait too long, he might never survive a move. 10 months have now passed, and Keiko's new home is rapidly nearing completion.
A lot of worry, a lot of headaches, and a lot of sleepless nights since February. There's just a lot of stress. All the life support systems running, we'll be working on that for the next several weeks. Right now, we're just flowing on adrenaline. This is the ozone tower. That ozone will be used to treat the water. Inside is the machine that runs it. This is the freezer behind me. It's designed to store 120,000 pounds of frozen fish. The pool is done. Everything's ready to go. It's been operational all this week, but there's a lot of cosmetic things we'll still be cleaning up for the rest of this month. But we're ready for Keiko. His home is ready.
In Mexico City, a C-130 cargo plane arrives, donated by United Parcel Service for the move. A massive construction crane is positioned. It will lift the huge container in which Keiko will ride.
So he's going to go backwards?
He's going to go backwards to the airport, and, okay. Which is fine. That's not a problem.
Spin it there.
And then we don't even have to spin it around because it's going to go into the airplane nose first, so it'll come right off the back of the truck.
Okay.
For Dave Phillips and Lanny Cornell, the logistics of airlifting a 7,000-pound orca seem to get no less complex, despite months of detailed planning. More than 20,000 people a day now pour through the gates of Reino Aventura to bid farewell to their beloved friend. But even while the fans are saying goodbye, Phillips and one of the veterinarians are suddenly not sure if Keiko will be leaving at all.
Lanny, this is Dave. I'm down here at poolside, and we have a problem of what I would say is major proportions. I'm here with Dr. Solorzano. We found out all of about 3 hours ago that UPS is demanding that unless we get Keiko to the airport 4:15, they pull the plug and we have no relocation. And Reino has got everything planned down here for 7 a.m. departure. We've got police escorts. We've got every single government official prepared to have this whale out of here. And it sounds like only 3 hours difference, but I can tell you, we are in serious risk of not getting Keiko out of here.
A last-minute change in departure time could jeopardize the entire operation. On the last day, Keiko's final performances are sold out. Like all great performers, Keiko rises to the occasion with an unforgettable final performance. The outpouring of affection is overwhelming. Everyone realizes that this is the last time they will see Keiko in Mexico. Even while Keiko is performing his last show, the tone behind the scenes is far less buoyant.
Are we going to pull the plug and start again? If so, what are we going to do, Dr. Quayle?
Dave Phillips and Reino Aventura operations director Alejandro Askew grapple with the logistics of Keiko's move.
We have already said, as you notice,
it's like changing the time of the Super Bowl.
Exactly.
And how it now impacts on a whole sequence of events that have been set for months.
Order of importance. Why it is that we cannot leave at 7, why we have to be wheels up at 4.
Is that question to me?
That question is to you. Yeah, hold a sec. We need more volume on you, too.
Okay. The situation, as I've been counseled with it, is if this all has to do with the requirements of lifting the whale and the weight at a certain time based on the climatic conditions of Mexico.
And there's going to be that much difference between 4 o'clock and 7 o'clock in terms of air temperature in Mexico City?
My understanding is that if it reaches 50 or 55 degrees somewhere around that neighborhood, and I can get the technical support for that, but that we will not be able to lift that aircraft. UPS will do anything it has to do to safely transport that whale.
After hours of delicate negotiations and reorganization, a compromise is reached. The plane must take off by 5 a.m. or it won't take off at all. By midnight on moving day, everything is ready to go. But first, Keiko must be coaxed by his handlers into a small holding tank. Despite months of rehearsals, he seems to sense that something is wrong and refuses to enter. He cleverly avoids the capture net twice, but on the third try is gently guided into position. A team of U.S. and Mexican trainers ease into the water and comfort Keiko in preparation for the big moment. First, he must be fitted into a customized canvas sling. For months, this has been a routine part of Keiko's daily training. But Dr. Cornell is concerned that the roar of the crane, the bright lights, and the hundreds of spectators may cause Keiko to panic. With the sling finally in place, Carla and the others dry Keiko before covering his back with a moisturizing cream to keep his skin from drying out during the long trip. Their soothing touch gives Keiko final reassurance before he is lifted from the water. In the wild, a whale out of water is a whale about to die. All are now given to wonder. What thoughts must be flooding his mind? Does he recall that traumatic night nearly two decades ago when he was taken from his family in much the same way by another group of humans? Hanging in the night sky, so vulnerable, Keiko's fate lies once again completely in human hands. Keiko could never survive a fall from this height. He must remain calm and not panic. Keiko Keiko will remain in the sling for the 14-hour ordeal that lies ahead. 3,000 pounds of ice are added to water that half fills his container. It is essential that Keiko stays cool. Warm-blooded, orcas can overheat and suddenly die during transport. It is now 2 a.m. A secret route to the airport has been planned by the Mexican authorities, but Keiko's departure is anything but secret. No one is prepared for the scene that awaits the convoy outside the gates of Reino Aventura. The scene quickly erupts into a wild, spontaneous parade as thousands of people follow and also delay the Keiko Express all the way to the airport.
Beyond anything I would have expected in my in my wildest dreams.
Really amazing. I mean, at this hour.
At this hour.
Gosh.
Now, seriously behind schedule, the crew begins to load the massive live cargo into the plane. Roller bars are positioned on which the 15-ton package will glide.
Bring that out. That pipe, yeah.
But suddenly, the crate lurches forward and comes to a grinding halt. A roller is hopelessly jammed. The crew works frantically for hours, and even more time is lost. Could it be that Keiko has come this far only to die, stranded on a runway? His vital signs are monitored, and Carla and Renata do their best to reassure him. Two tense hours later, at 5 a.m., the jammed roller is freed, and Keiko disappears into the belly of the plane. Due to weight limitations, only doctors Cornell and Solorzano will accompany Keiko on the long flight. The others will follow in a smaller plane. As they ascend into the pre-dawn sky, Keiko begins his journey home, fueled by the love and blessings of the people of Mexico. Behind schedule, Keiko's plane must first land in Phoenix, Arizona, for refueling. Carla and Renata are eager to check on the passenger. Keiko's body heat has melted all of the ice. The water in his container has become much too warm. Even though further delay is risky, Dr. Cornell orders 2,000 pounds of ice and a change of water before they can proceed. It The flight crew then receives a report that bad weather threatens to close the airport in Newport, Oregon. Rerouting the plane would mean another setback. But bad weather ahead gives them less than 2 hours to complete the original flight plan. For Keiko, the odds seem to be getting worse. It's now a race against the wind and rain closing in on the Oregon coast. But at last, with a break from Mother Nature, air traffic control clears the plane for landing. A stampede of reporters from around the globe has descended upon this quiet little town to cover Keiko's story. Hundreds of journalists and thousands of spectators have been waiting for hours in the rain.
Keiko's just doing great. Talk to the vet, everything's okay. So we're gonna be trying to get into the aquarium as fast as we can.
Keiko has been in the container for more than 16 stressful hours and yet miraculously has remained calm.
All right. Is he calm? All right.
The small town of Newport turns out to welcome their new resident. Children can't believe that Keiko, the hero of Free Willy, is going to be their neighbor. The entire world watches via satellite. The first leg of Keiko's incredible journey is about to come to an end. Exaltation soon gives way to concerned apprehension. One last and most dangerous maneuver must first be accomplished. Keiko must be lifted one last time. Suspended 45 feet above the cameras, Keiko's patience and trust must now surely be tested. The noise and bright light seem to stir him, or perhaps it's the sight and smell of the salt water. Whatever the reason, it appears that Keiko will wait no longer. The order is given, and with a final roar of the giant crane, Keiko is safely back in his natural element. Suddenly, it appears that he may be caught in the cables. His trainers risk life and limb to make sure that he's clear. And finally, Keiko swims free into the cold blue water of his new home. Keiko's triumph makes headlines around the world. He's front page news. It's clear that Keiko has become the world's most famous whale. He's an overnight sensation, even appearing on network television.
How's Keiko adapting to his new home there in Oregon?
You're doing just beautifully.
But again, it was the children who had inspired Keiko's rescue.
All these kids from around the world started becoming the force behind the plan for doing the right thing for Keiko. They were writing to us by the droves saying, why can't Keiko find a new home?
Across the United States and around the world, they raised nearly $100,000 to help build Keiko's new home. Keiko's biggest fans, the children, understood and championed his right to be with his family.
I hope he comes to Newport safely and, you know, he gets a better life.
So we can get him back in the ocean to return him to the wild.
I'd like to see him go back into the ocean with his family.
Their pods are split apart and they need to be together.
Inspired by such youthful exuberance, adults followed suit. Warner Brothers and the McCaw Foundation contributed the final millions necessary to complete the project. It has been a gargantuan undertaking, but fantastic achievements often spring from the purest minds. And so, Keiko, who once floated here only in the clear blue of our imaginations, awaits our next move to guide him safely on his journey home. Within days of Keiko's arrival, it seems clear that he enjoys his new home. For the first time in over 15 years, he is able to dive and leap, to all-out swim in cold natural seawater in a place five times bigger than his pool in Mexico. The state-of-the-art design includes rock formations, natural acoustics, and random currents, all to simulate his wild ocean habitat. One of the most revealing signs of Keiko's new outlook surprises everyone. In a rare display, Keiko suddenly begins to vocalize.
I laid down on the side of the pool and started whistling to him like the trainers in Mexico had to call him, and all of a sudden he broke into this killer whale vocalization that went on and on and on.
Dr. Cornell wonders if Keiko recalls this dialect from his youth. To help answer this important question, the Free Willy Foundation turns to Dr. Roger Payne, a world-renowned expert on whale vocalization and acoustic science.
Killer whales make sounds which have components and elements in them which occur all over the world in all killer whale groups. But for every family of killer whales, there is a specific few sounds which only that family makes.
Dr. Payne enters Keiko's vocalizations into a computer program that converts the sound into an image, or spectrograph. Much like a fingerprint, these images identify Keiko's unique language structure and will perhaps provide a clue in finding his family. A hopeful match to the sounds of a group of wild orcas still living in Iceland. There are an estimated 6 orca families living along Iceland's eastern coast. Of these, 5 have been recorded. It's now clear that Keiko is speaking a dialect common to these orcas. But to which family? Many hours of research are needed to finally make that match. It is a true environmental detective story. But thanks to Keiko's newfound desire to speak, one that someday may be solved. No matter what his remarkable progress, Keiko's eventual release lies in the hands of humans and the politics of government. Iceland. A rugged island nation of 250,000 people, derives more than 3/4 of its economy from fishing. But over a 10-year period, nearly 100 orcas were also taken from its waters. President of the Icelandic Whale Friends Society, Magnus Skeppardason, recalls the controversy.
We managed to get the nation a little more aware of what is behind this. This is a suffer for these individuals. These are living beings that are aware of that they are taken from their families. I think all animal abuse is bad, especially if you abuse animals that are aware of what's happening. And look on this incident. These were 2 or 3 years old babies that were taken here in 1979 when Keiko was caught here and taken in imprisonment. And he hasn't seen his family all his life. Imagine how furious the world would be if a child would have been taken from their family and taken into slavery for some exhibitionism in the world. So I'm more glad than any words can express that this Free Willy work is starting now in reality, and I will be very, very glad when the Willy will come home and will be released into its natural environment where its family most likely still is.
The news of Keiko's plight first reached Iceland in 1994, shortly after Free Willy was released. The small village of Eskifjord was one of the first to volunteer their help. One idea proposes that Keiko could live in a fjord, protected by a sea pen, until his ability to survive in the wild is tested. Keiko's return also has the surprising support of Eskifjord's fishermen.
This will be considered to be a major event here, and I'm absolutely certain that everybody will lend a helping hand in making this possible. It would be fantastic to have Keiko come back to Eskifjörður. I can assure you of that.
There could hardly be a better place than Eskifjord for Keiko's eventual release. Located along the migration route of Iceland's orcas, Keiko would be able to hear and respond to others of his kind. But the final word on his return rests with the government in Reykjavik. And just like negotiations in Mexico, politics will determine the outcome. Until that day comes, Keiko continues to make remarkable progress. constant swimming has brought him newfound strength and energy. For Carla, the ocean water is so cold at 49 degrees that she now needs a wetsuit. But Keiko thrives. He now eats nearly twice as much, 200 pounds of restaurant-quality herring and capelin each day. In 6 months, he has already gained over 1,000 pounds. His flippers have increased an amazing 6 inches in width, and he's already grown nearly a foot in length. Keiko seems to enjoy the measurements and gets in on the act by holding the tape measure in his mouth. But most amazing is that his skin virus has nearly healed.
How many percent down do you think it is over the last 3 months?
I think it's probably 80% normal now, whereas even a month ago it was only like 50 or 60%. It's really, really dramatically improving.
It's less than 3 months.
The improvement of the lesions from when Keiko first arrived to 6 months later is astounding. Dr. Cornell believes the combination of cold natural seawater, better diet, and freedom from the stress of performing have all contributed to his healing. At this rate, Keiko's virus could be gone within the year. A big screen TV has been installed so that Keiko can watch and listen to wild orcas. He's attracted to it and seems to enjoy scenes of orcas leaping.
Looking much healthier. I mean, the papilloma is looking amazing. It's just definitely much better. He's more active and he's gaining weight. And he's acting silly all the time. He's playing and he's really active. He really looks healthier and happier.
Keiko has begun to spy hop spontaneously, a technique used by orcas to break the surface and look around. After 15 years of being hand-fed, perhaps the most important tool Keiko must learn is to hunt for food. Nolan Harvey supervises training sessions where Keiko learns to recognize and locate hidden objects.
Well, one of the first things we've done with Keiko is teach him to respond to the shape. This is his shape, this primary shape. The idea is to use his brain to get him to start thinking, maybe start hunting down an object, looking for a specific object, which hopefully will give him the idea that he can use his brain to go out and find things.
Good boy!
And it is just the basis of a starting on a hunting type of behavior within this bull.
Live fish could introduce parasites, and so for now, human praise and herring are Keiko's reward.
Good boy, you're okay.
Most revealing of all are the results of the blood tests. Keiko's immune system is far stronger than at any time before, an indication that the team's plan is working. But his 6 months of success mark another inevitable milestone. Now it is time for Carla and Renata to leave their beloved friend and return home. For them, it is a time of celebration and sadness.
When the time comes to say goodbye, I'll definitely say, oh God, this is hard. I'll say I love you very much. I don't know. This is very hard.
5 long years of caring must come to an end.
And I know I'm living part of my life, the most important part of my life here. So, that's it.
As hard as it is to leave, Carla and Renata know that they must. In order for Keiko to gain the independence he will need to survive in the wild. Keiko's journey home is in part a story of human nature. What began with cruelty and greed has been eclipsed by our compassion and love. A love that can heal a whale. A love that can heal us all.